Intro to SPS Commercial Documents, Health Certificates, Import Notifications, and General Licenses. Hi there. And wherever you are. A warm welcome to you. Thank you for choosing this video. And it is jam-packed. Bursting at the seams. With information about customs SPS controls. And all aimed at beginners too. So where are we? We are on the front page of the UK Border Operating Model, December 2020 version. And starting this intro with some information that might prove useful for later. Let's click the more info icon up here to open a playlist. And twols club videos are available with or without background music. Let's click on one of these playlists to open it up. Fab. You can also watch me open the border operating model in a couple of these earlier videos. General aspects, over here, for example. Anyway, expect more videos to be added here over time. And just for your information, let's quickly list the videos to be added here. Okay, great. By now, I'm hoping you will have enjoyed my earlier explorations of the EU-GB trade agreement, rules of origin, commodity codes, etc., etc. If not, it's a good idea to watch these videos in order. You will find that this playlist contains introductory videos covering many topics, including sites, SPS goods, harmonized standards, and a lot more too. Various aspects of the UK customs border. Just click to open one of these videos and check out the video description to find out more. For example, I explored what is meant by goods, such as sanitary and phytosanitary goods, in an earlier twols club video called Conventions and Controls. And another point to keep in mind right now is that in 2021, UK border controls for SPS goods are based on EU harmonized rules. So, why am I telling you all this? Well, if you don't know what is meant by SPS goods, or even harmonized rules, also referred to as harmonized standards, then I recommend you watch this Conventions and Controls video first to get a better idea of these things. It includes some other stuff too. All good. And by watching Conventions and Controls, you will get a richer understanding of the content following in this particular video and these other SPS videos too. Great, close out of here. And once again, you can get fast access to the Conventions and Controls video simply by clicking that More Info icon in the top right corner. Good stuff. Okay, great. In this video, I explore border controls and regulations for imports of sanitary and phytosanitary goods and products. Before we start, a quick word on animal welfare. And animal welfare regulations are different from sanitary and phytosanitary controls and regulations. But if your business deals with live animals, or if you have a personal interest in animal welfare, then you might also be interested in the following twols club video. Introduction to welfare regulations for farm animals and equines in transport. That video includes explanations of transporter authorizations, certificates of vehicle approval, and journey logs, plus more too. So, if you are interested in animal welfare, particularly welfare regulations concerning animals in transport, then, if you like, check out that video to learn more about these topics. It includes other related topics too. That's nice. Introduction to welfare regulations for farm animals and equines in transport. Earmark and check it out later. Hurrah. Okay, great. So, what is going to follow in this particular video? Well, we certainly have our work cut out. If you don't know what is meant by SPS commercial documents, SPS health certificates, import pre-notifications or SPS general licenses, or you are a bit unsure of any of these things, then rest easy. You are in the right place. As this video is for beginners, we are not going to be doing anything complicated, but we are indeed going to explore these items, plus more, and all in this video. And here is the order of things. To start, we'll list the 7 different suites of SPS border controls, just to learn the names really. And then we'll quickly discuss the reasoning behind the staging of controls at the UK border. And after that, we'll explore these border elements. And these are some of the elements, including sources of help, that are part of the different suites of SPS border controls. And this is all followed by a quick summary at the end of this video. But to reiterate, you will get a better, more in-depth experience if you have already watched the twols club Conventions and Controls video. So watch that video first before this video. But also bear in mind that the information in this video will help you better understand the next 7 videos too. To reiterate, You need to watch everything in this video in order to better understand the content in the next 7 SPS videos following after this one. Each of the next 7 videos focuses on one particular suite of SPS controls. And in those videos, we get a better idea of when some of the border elements discussed in this video are applied at the UK customs border. Hurrah! All for beginners. And all this better with headphones too. But also, any updates released in 2021 will also be included in these other videos, as and where appropriate. Okay, great. Moving on. And starting with the list of staged SPS controls. Sanitary and phytosanitary controls. Let's set this to actual size. And we can list these suites of controls if we scroll down to page 2. And right now, we are just getting used to the SPS category names given here. Nothing more. An easy start. And so, the listing of the 7 groups of SPS control types are given as animal products, animal byproducts and products of animal origin under safeguard measures. Additional requirements for fishery products and live bivalve mollusks. High-risk food and feed not of animal origin, HRFNAO. Live animals and germinal products. Live aquatic animals for aquaculture and ornamental purposes. Equines. And last but not least, plants and plant products. And don't forget, a separate Twols Club video will be available, describing each of these suites, or groupings, of SPS controls. And the UK and European Union will administer SPS measures on their borders as 2 separate and distinct customs territories post-transition from January 2021. One thing to note. These new UK SPS border controls, released in stages at the UK border, commonly control the movement of goods between the EU and UK. But in this video, and in the 7 videos following after this one, I focus on UK SPS controls that affect UK imports from the EU, including any EFTA countries following EU harmonised rules as well. And once again, I explored the harmonising process in the Twols Club video called Conventions and Controls. Okay, great. But why were UK border controls released in stages? Let's jump down to page 8. And what do we see? In 2020, recognizing the impact of coronavirus on businesses' ability to prepare, the UK government took the decision to introduce the new border controls in 3 separate stages. Pause to read as you like. And originally, the release dates for each stage were as follows. Stage 1. The 1st of January 2021. Stage 2. The 1st of April 2021. And down a bit. Stage 3. The 1st of July 2021. But since then, and after this PDF was published, from around March 2021, the UK government pushed back these dates you see here. Why? I guess to give more time for border preparations. To give more time for businesses to adjust to the new rules at the UK border. To give more time to mitigate the effects of coronavirus. And that is great. Hurrah. So, bearing all that in mind, in each of the following 7 SPS videos, I not only discuss the type of goods subject to UK sanitary and phytosanitary import controls, but also we see when the various border control elements discussed in this video come into effect for each of those 7 different types of goods. To reiterate, to keep things simple, we'll check out the new dates in each of the 7 SPS videos that follow directly after this one. Fab. Moving on. Border control elements. And these are made up of physical and documentary checks, border control posts, and more. But what are all these things? Okay, let's find out. Border control elements. A beginner's introduction to SPS checks and controls. SPS commercial documents. Health certificates. Import pre-notifications. And more. Hurrah. Now, we focus on the additional controls that UK and EU traders face when moving SPS goods across the UK-EU border. Controls that are additional to the ordinary declarations required for imports and exports. Fab. So, from previous Twols Club videos, such as conventions and controls and general aspects, we already know that, right from the start of January 2021, traders should expect full customs border controls for controlled goods, such as endangered species, excise goods, and so on. These are not staged. For the rest of this video, we focus just on SPS controls, a significant portion of which are staged. We've already seen, in very simple terms, the old schedule for the staged sanitary and phytosanitary controls, but not the new dates, and we're not going to focus on stage release dates in this video. Instead, we'll touch on the stage release dates in the next 7 videos to follow. So, what next? In order to prepare for the forthcoming videos, and to get a better understanding of the nature of individual control types, I want to spend the rest of this video discussing border control elements. Border control elements. A variety of terminology, acronyms, and various control types you might see in relation to SPS goods movements. I'm also going to mix in sources of help and information too. Hurrah! To start with, page 34. This PDF download also gives us a handy list of definitions for the different types of SPS controls, including a variety of checks. Remember, do pause to read as and when you like. Okay then. We see definitions for import pre-notifications. Actually, I'll read this out a bit later. Health certificates, and I'll read this paragraph later too. But we also see this is followed by documentary, identity and physical checks. What do we see? Worth taking note. Documentary checks. Documentary checks are examinations of official certifications, attestations and other commercial documents that are required to accompany a consignment. And documentary checks can occur remotely, away from the border, or at a BCP. And we'll get to BCPs in just a moment. Identity checks. And identity checks include a visual inspection to verify the content and labeling of a consignment corresponds to the information provided in accompanying documentation. For example, a visual inspection of live animals may involve checking marks on animals to make sure they correspond to the official documents. A physical check means a check on, for example, the means of transport, the condition of an animal, where appropriate, and may include sampling for analysis. A physical check entails a check on the goods to verify that they are compliant with the sanitary and phytosanitary import requirements for GB. To reiterate, this may involve both visual and physical checks to verify the health of the animals, the consignment's packaging, means of transport and labeling. Physical checks may also involve temperature sampling for analysis. Laboratory testing or diagnosis may also be required. Fab. Moving on. Border control posts, BCP. Entry of SPS goods will be via an established point of entry with what is called an appropriate border control post or BCP. And entry will only be via a BCP by the time staging expires. Spending a moment. Checks on SPS goods are necessary to protect animals, plants, and public health. You may see border control posts or BCPs, also referred to as border inspection posts, BIPs. So, what is a BCP? What do they do? These BCPs can range in functionality depending on their individual designations. A border control post is an inspection post, designated and approved, in line with legislation, and importantly, equipped to carry out checks on very specific products and product types coming into the UK from overseas. Some exports may also require to leave the UK via a BCP. The European Union will also have their own border control posts /border inspection posts too. And points of entry or exit for the UK or EU may be equipped with border control posts, designed for very different purposes. That's nice. But how does staging BCPs affect imports? Okay, great. Staged SPS controls and BCPs. As part of the staged approach to SPS controls, prior to the end of staged controls, if importing certain SPS goods from non-EU countries to GB, but via the customs controls of the European Union, then UK customs will treat the goods, for example, plants and plant products, let's say, as if they were an EU import. And how does this affect such SPS imports during the staging process at the UK border? Well, if these have already passed customs controls in the European Union, then this just means that such goods can enter the UK via any point of entry. On the other hand, any imports that haven't entered into free circulation within the European Union, i.e., if these goods did not pass EU customs controls and were not checked by the EU, then they will be treated as if they are a direct import from a third country, a non-EU country of origin. As such, any unchecked imports will have to enter the UK via an appropriate BCP and undergo formal UK inspections and checks. However, as we see up here, this all changes by the time staging expires, when all SPS goods, irrespective of previous checks, will have to enter the UK via the appropriate border control post and potentially undergo the full range of checks. Why is that? The phased approach to import controls will have expired and have been replaced by full UK sovereign border controls. UK checks on imports of SPS goods will be in line with UK rules and regulations in order to protect animals, plants, and UK public health. This means that after staging expires, any previous checks in the European Union will no longer be valid in the UK. Therefore, to repeat, all SPS imports into the UK will need to be inspected and checked at an appropriate UK border control post. And extending the dates for this staged approach gives more time for border readiness preparations. Very interesting. Let's list some BCPs next. Okay, great. Here is a list of border control posts, BCP, in the UK, for the import of live animals, animal products, and food and feed of non-animal origin. As we've already seen, BCP, a customs inspection point equipped to deal with specific categories of goods. What about BCPs for plant imports? Okay. Here is a list. A big long list. Cool. And we can scroll down a bit. And no doubt, we could find other types of BCPs too. For now. Close out of here. Next. Requirements for imports from EA/EFTA countries. EFTA is made up of a handful of non-EU countries. And the EEA agreement simply extends the European single market to EFTA countries. Hurrah! So, what does it say here? In brief, where these countries are harmonized with EU SPS standards, then the phasing of UK SPS import control arrangements will apply uniformly in these countries. Otherwise, if any of these countries are not harmonized with EU SPS standards, then the existing arrangements between the UK and any non-harmonized EFTA countries will apply. As an aside, in the Twols Club video, Conventions and Controls, we saw that the harmonizing procedure is applied to non-food goods. And now, as we can understand from what we've seen, the harmonizing procedure, or something similar, is also applied to rules relating to sanitary and phytosanitary goods too. And that's nice. But to reiterate, if and when you like, watch my interpretation of the harmonizing procedure in the Twols Club video called Conventions and Controls. Okay, fab. Moving on. This mini set of definitions for traders is repeated again at the start of stage 2. Click that. Great. Very interesting. And now let's build further upon what we see here and on page 34. We'll further expand, flesh out, and boost our understanding of SPS controls. Let's start by looking at terms, acronyms, and abbreviations. And we'll follow up with more. Much more. And all in preparation for the videos that follow this one. I'll keep it simple too, you lucky people. Okay. Some more definitions from Twols Club. In no particular order. Raw products, rest of the world goods and products. What are these? Page 36. For example, raw goods. Goods not from the domestic customs territory. And related to raw or rest of world is the term third country, page 39. And if you are looking at EU regulations, then a third country will be any country outside of the EU customs territory. If you are looking at GB regulations, a third country is any country outside of the UK customs territory. And third country goods and raw products therefore pretty much mean the same thing. Goods not from the domestic customs territory. Great. Moving on. DEFRA, Department for Environment, Food and Rural Affairs. Let's scroll the contact page on gov.uk. Featured. Down a bit. Latest news. Followed by a high-level breakdown of what DEFRA actually does. Given also as latest updates on services, guidance, news, research, policy, FOI, and no doubt, a lot more not seen here. Scrolling down a bit. And contacts down here. Okay. Also, APHA, Animal and Plant Health Agency. Let's scroll their page too. And contact details. And lots of help and contacts on the DEFRA and APHA web pages. For example, for your plant or animal-related SPS imports, you might need one or more of the following. Health certificates. Import licenses. Pre-notifications. Commercial documents and more. And we'll cover these items and more, just shortly. But you can find out exactly what paperwork you need for your plant and animal product SPS imports from APHA. It's also worth remembering that APHA even have a vet gateway. A resource used in conjunction with certain certificates and attestations that we'll discuss later. Note that, at the time of writing, this link was not an HTTPS address. So, watch out for that. And that's nice. Close the vet gateway. But APHA has many customer services centers. And we can find these if We scroll down a bit. Here they are. And you can send correspondence in English or Welsh. The first one is the Center for International Trade, Carlisle. Remember that too. You might see this center abbreviated to CITC in the UK border operating model. And there are a few customer services centers, as well as veterinary delivery partners and investigation team contacts given near the bottom here. And more. Press inquiries. APHA headquarters. And complaints at the bottom. Great. Close this. And we'll discuss certificates and licenses, software, etc. But first, some words on abbreviations. Abbreviations for various SPS goods. And we're on page 29. And you will also see abbreviations such as ABP. This stands for animal byproducts. POAO. Products of animal origin. HRFNAO. And this is high-risk food and feed, not of animal origin. If you want to find out more about ABP, POAO, HRFNAO, as well as the other types of SPS goods and products, then I explore these in detail in the Twols Club videos following after this one. But to repeat from earlier, all the information explored in this video will help you better understand those forthcoming videos too. And that's nice. For now. In the rest of this video, we'll explore commercial documents, export health certificates, EHCs, import pre-notifications, plus some related forms and a few related apps too. And after that, we'll briefly look at different types of licenses you might both need and need to know about prior to organizing your import. All to follow in this video. Great. So starting with commercial documents. So, what is a commercial document? Commercial documents are obtained from the supplier or sender, and these contain full details of the items and products you are importing, including category and quantity, date of transport, the name and address of both the sender and the recipient, approval or registration numbers for the factory, and vehicle, I guess, a signature of the person responsible for the contents, and where carcasses have been taken from farms, then also included are identification numbers and details of the species. We see. You should keep a copy of the commercial document for at least 2 years. And more information down here on using commercial documents and logbooks for keeping records of consignments, and just a bit below that. Notes on labeling. As a side note, when transporting animal byproducts, ABPs, how to register to move animal byproducts, ABPs, safely, how they should be moved, and the paperwork you need. Scrolling to the bottom. And we see. To add to our discussion on paperwork. When paperwork is not needed. You don't need paperwork for ABPs if a truck or container is carrying derived retail products in category 3, for example bone meal from a garden center. Also, compound animal feed, where Food Standards Agency, FSA, controls are active. And milk products, from a plant, approved, under FSA regulations. And we discuss category 1, 2 and 3 ABP in the following video. But, in all cases, anyone unsure about paperwork should contact APHA to verify their requirements. Fab. Moving on. Okay. Up next. Some more examples of paperwork required in relation to certain SPS goods moving from the EU to the UK. Health certificates, import pre-notifications, and more. Okay, back to page 34. And export health certificates. The traditional European Union health certificates need to travel with livestock and other appropriate SPS goods when these are moved from the EU to GB. These are substantially the same as the existing EU certificates used by the rest of the world to import SPS goods into the EU. So, to reiterate, for animal and high-risk animal products, an export health certificate, EHC, from the EU usually accompanies exports to the UK. But health certificates are also central to the process by which both animal health and animal product documentary checks are carried out remotely. How does that work? We'll get a better idea in just a few minutes. Hurrah! But what is an EHC? In general, an export health certificate, EHC, is an official document that confirms the export meets the health requirements of the destination country. And you may also see a health certificate, referred to as an intra-trade animal health certificate, ITAHC, or ITARC. So what information is given on the export health certificate? Different products will require different details from the exporter regarding the consignment, though this will generally include details of the country of origin, place of destination, nature of transport, a unique reference number, as well as a health attestation of the consignment, as signed by an authorized official or appointed vet. Tell me more about the attestation. Okay. For example, with regard to consignments of live animals, and most products of animal origin, for instance, the health certificate will require the consignment to be inspected by an official veterinarian, in order to verify that the consignment's contents meet the health requirements of the destination country. And related to this, don't forget the vet gateway we saw earlier on the APHA pages. But who is responsible for generating an export health certificate? A health certificate will need to be secured by the exporter, from the EU country of origin's competent authority. A recognized authority, with which the exporter is registered. And I should also imagine that an original and genuine health certificate must not be issued retrospectively after the goods have already been sent. More specifically, the health certificate must not be issued retrospectively with regard to the date of loading and dispatch to the destination country. And an individual health certificate is required for each species, each type of product, and each destination. Therefore, a single export may consist of multiple consignments that each require a health certificate to accompany the consignment. So potentially, lots of health certificate paperwork and vet checks for exporters to manage before the start of a multi-SPS export movement. The original EHC travels with the goods, but as a heads up, a copy also needs to be uploaded into IPAFS. And we'll discuss IPAFS later in this video. For now, for goods movements heading to GB, let's list different types of health certificates that importers might need to upload into IPAFS. Many different types of health certificates can be obtained from here. Here we have a collection. Health certificates for animal and animal product imports into Great Britain. Find the health certificate you need for a live animal or animal product import to Great Britain, the Channel Islands, or Isle of Man from 2021. And lots of links for different health certificates listed here for different product types. Let's scroll down to eyeball these links. Take note that we explain these individual product types more fully in Twols Club videos following this one. But I'll also point out fish-related certificates here and there as we scroll down. Pause where you like. Health certificates are required for imports of animal byproducts, ABP, such as fish oils, etc. Live animals too, including fish and shellfish, equines, germinal products, products of animal origin, BOAO, including fish products, and high-risk food and feed, not of animal origin, HRFNAO, at the bottom. Under Other. If you need help finding your health certificate, contact APHA via CITC, England and Wales. And, as we shall see later, an EHC is part of the staged approach to import controls at the UK border. So keep an eye open for that in the SPS videos that follow after this one. On top of that, take note that the importer also needs a copy of the health certificate, EHC, as this is part of the import pre-notification process too. Tell me more about that. Okay. We'll do that next. And at the same time, we'll find out more about how data on the health certificate is used. Hurrah. Close out of here. Back on page 34. Import pre-notifications. The importer also needs to notify the authorities in advance of the arrival of the import. And as with export health certificates, the requirement for import pre-notifications for certain SPS goods is phased in over the staging process at the UK border. So, keep an eye open for that in the following 7 videos too. Okay, so I want to look at 2 methods for submitting import pre-notifications. For example, UK importers can pre-notify APHA by using a new UK facility called IPAFS, an online notification system. And we will touch upon IPAFS in just a few minutes. Before that, let's read this out. Import pre-notifications. Part of a goods movement process for certain goods, an import pre-notification refers to the means by which importers provide advance notice to relevant regulatory bodies of a consignment's arrival into GB or EU. The means by which importers provide advance notice is typically a standardized import notification form that requires the importer to provide details regarding the consignment, such as the consignment's country of origin, place of destination, the specific species /product, and general details for the importer, exporter and transporter. And you may see a variety of import pre-notification forms serving the UK /EU, with each form catering for a particular type of product. I'll discuss the CVED import pre-notification form as an example, but we'll briefly look at a few others too. Okay, not to dwell. The CVED. Okay. Let's call it the CVED. Just in case you see mention of the CVED or CVED. Let's expand on this a little bit. Before IPAFS, there was traces and the CVED. We will introduce traces in a short while. First, let's explore the CVID. The Common Veterinary Entry Document, or CVID. Before Brexit, and whilst the UK was still part of the European Union, the CVID was commonly used, in both the UK and EU, to notify the authorities, in advance, of imports of live animals and animal products. The CVID is separate from a health certificate, but the export health certificate or the details contained have always been used as part of the import pre-notification process. And details from each export health certificate needs to be provided on a separate Common Veterinary Entry Document, or CVID. In this way, the Common Veterinary Entry Document, CVED, provides a pre-notification that includes the veterinary assessment of live animals or animal products. And to reiterate, where an import includes multiple EHCs, a separate CVED must be completed and submitted for each EHC. And why is that? The UK authorities need to complete documentary checks in advance of arrival. But on top of this, on arrival, the export health certificate details can be verified. But also, the CVID can be used as supporting documentation for any identity and physical checks too. And once these have been carried out by the UK authorities, the official sections of the CVID are completed, signed and stamped by an authorised officer or official veterinary surgeon, and both the original and a copy are returned to the agent /importer. And the authorised copy must remain with the consignment until its arrival at the premises of destination, the address of which is as stated on the health certificate or commercial documentation. But this page also lists some more CVID importer requirements. And scrolling down we see, for a CVID to be stamped and reissued by authorities, the following original documents must be submitted to the Port Health Office as appropriate for the import. As we already know, the authorities, such as APHA or the Port Health Office, BCP, etc. want to see health certificates, the original that travels with the goods. But given here is a very handy list of other items. Pause as you like. We also see more notes on invoices /packing lists. Notes on charges. Common Veterinary Entry Document, CVED, charges. Under that, the Common Entry Document, or CED. This is used when importing high-risk food and feed of non-animal origin, HRFNAO. And we discuss HRFNAO in a separate video later. What about when importing fish or marine animals? We see documentation related to fishing. Illegal, unreported and unregulated fishing. IUU fishing. And we also discuss controls regulating IUU fishing in a separate SPS video. And at the bottom, food and feed imports from Japan. And we can imagine that safeguarding issues change over time. And new issues also arise. So, it's wise to keep an eye on DEFRA and APHA webpages, as well as guidance on HRFNAO to keep up to date. Make sure you are aware of any licenses required for particular types of goods imports too. We'll touch on licenses later in this video. And that's fab. But do contact APHA prior to starting an import to get the exact requirements for your goods movement. And whilst on the subject of pre-notification forms, let's take a brief look at new varieties called CHEDs. CHED. What is a CHED? CHED. Common Health Entry Document, CHED or CHED. As of the 14th of December, 2019, several versions of the Common Health Entry Document became mandatory for imports of specific varieties of plant and animal goods into the EU. And there are a variety of CHEDs, each specific to a particular category of SPS import. Each type of CHED is raised by the importer, and to reiterate, it is a pre-notification for a type of SPS import into the EU. The raised CHED is also used by customs authorities to record the outcome of controls and decisions taken on the import, as well as the follow-up measures applied to the import after a decision has been made. And that's nice. So, what's next? The IV70 form. Let's take a very quick look at the UK import notification form used for products of animal origin under safeguard measures, IV70. Fill in this form if you need to pre-notify APHA of your import of POAO goods under safeguard measures, where safeguard measures are in place because of a new or emerging disease in the country of origin, resulting in the commodity code for your import becoming unavailable in IPAFs. And that's nice. So, we've touched upon a few different types of import pre-notification forms. And today, these may serve a purpose if the importer does not have access to the relevant pre-notification software. When commodity codes become temporarily unavailable within the relevant software due to safeguarding measures having been activated. So, whenever necessary, contact authorities such as APHA to find the correct form for your needs. Okay, next. Let's look at IPAFs. Okay, great. IPAFS, Import of Products, Animals, Food and Feed System. IPAFS, the new system for pre-notifying UK authorities of SPS goods imports. When using IPAFS, details from each original health certificate are transcribed onto an equivalent domestic, UK, digital version. And these electronic copies are uploaded to IPAFS by the importer. The original version travels with the goods. So, let's quickly skim some guidance on IPAFS. Often part of an SPS goods movements process, UK importers use IPAFS to pre-notify APHA about the imports from the EU of live animals, germinal products, and animal byproducts, and products of animal origin under safeguard measures. It's good to keep all this in mind. But don't worry too much if you don't know what any of these items mean, because we describe these and more, HRFNAO and more, in the 7 videos after this one. So, keep scrolling down, and we see UK importers also use IPAFS to pre-notify APHA about imports from non-EU countries of live animals, POAO, and high-risk food and feed not of animal origin, HRFNAO. Also given here, notes to register for IPAFS. And pre-notifications must be made to APHA, or the appropriate BCP, as required, but at least 1 working day before the consignment is due to arrive from a non-EU country. Or at least a straight 24 hours, if the consignment is coming from any country that is part of the EU or is part of the EEA agreement. And just above the Start Now button. Details you need to provide, grouped according to when importing from EU or non-EU countries within the EEA. Cool. But you can also check if your animal product import must come from an approved establishment from here. Scrolling down. Pause to read as you like, but we see imports of high-risk animal byproducts, such as Cat 1 and Cat 2, ABP, as well as germinal products and products of animal origin, POAO, under safeguard measures, must all be supplied by establishments approved by their countries to trade with the UK. And we see, to import from EU member states, you need to manually enter details of the approved establishment in IPAFS, well, at least the approval number. And the steps given here. Scrolling down. Check what documents you need. One or all of health certificates, import licenses, and commercial documents. Contact APHA to clarify your situation. Fab. Keep scrolling down. And for certain movements, importers need to pass an IPAFS number back to the exporter and before the start of the goods movement. For example, when submitting your import notification for SPS goods such as live animals, germinal products, POAO goods under safeguard measures. Then, when using IPAFS, you will get a unique notification number, UNN. So, taking POAO goods under safeguard measures as our example here, and we see the UNN needs to be passed back to the exporter so that it can be included in the export health certificate and in any official veterinary documentation where applicable to. And all this to connect the IPAFS record to the health certificate data. And that's nice. Scrolling down, we see where there are new and emerging disease outbreaks and the importer's commodity code is unavailable in IPAFS, some help given here. 5 steps also including the IV70 form. Click that. Let's take a quick look. Scroll down a bit. Great. And back. Very quickly. Scrolling down to the bottom. And if you are unsure about anything, a link down here. A link to CITC, APHA's Centre for International Trade, in Carlisle, at the bottom. And that's nice. Click that. Okay. Not to dwell. Closing out of these pages. Up to the top. And we'll be revisiting this page in the next video. But IPAFS is the new replacement for the traditional European SPS pre-notification software. And I believe it was the EU version that was used by UK agricultural importers prior to Brexit. So, what is the original EU version called? Still used today to pre-notify imports into the EU. Traces NT. And it is still worth new UK traders, new UK exporters, etc. knowing a little about Traces NT. Why is that? IPAFS is the replacement for Traces NT for UK importers. The Trade Control and Expert System, Traces. But EU importers still need to submit pre-notifications to the relevant EU BCPs via Traces NT. Traces NT is a multilingual online platform used by EU importers for sanitary and phytosanitary certification. It streamlines pre-notifications and other processes required for the importation of animals, animal products, food and feed of non-animal origin, and plants into the European Union, as well as for intra-European Union trade and EU exports of animals and certain animal products. Traces does this by generating the necessary documents and sends copies to the appropriate authorities, inland and abroad, saving traders time and effort. The system allows traders to obtain export health certificates, which we saw earlier as intra, trade, animal, health certificates, or ATARCs, within Traces NT2, and it also provides movement notifications of their dispatches. Importers can also pre-notify border control posts, also known as border inspection posts, by completing part 1 of a CVED, within Traces NT. And importers are issued a unique CVED reference number, after completing part 1 of a CVED, when using Traces NT. Next, the EU importer sends their unique CVED number to the EU customs authorities, as part of the procedure to release their goods, held at the BIP. If an importer does not have access to Traces NT, then they can complete a standalone CVED form, and send that to the BCP instead. Pause as you like. And Traces NT also helps the authorities to meet health regulations and traders' needs. It is an efficient tool that, also, ensures traceability and risk management, as well as information exchange. As with IPAFs, pre-notifications need to be done at least one working day in advance of the goods arrival at an EU BCP. What about controls for plant products? We'll discuss controls for plants and plant products in a separate dedicated SPS video. And that's nice. Okay, next. A quick look at regulations, directives, decisions, recommendations, and opinions. And we're on an official website of the European Union. Regulations, directives, and other acts. So what is a regulation? We see. A regulation is a binding legislative act. It must be applied in its entirety across the EU. What about directives? What are those? Down a bit and we see. A directive is a legislative act that sets out a goal that all EU countries must achieve. However, it is up to the individual countries to devise their own laws on how to reach these goals. So, regulations and directives must be implemented by countries following EU rules, but whilst a regulation has to be followed by the letter, a directive can be achieved in a manner that best suits countries, and these are implemented on a national level. Okay, fab. But we also see decisions. What are these? Down a bit. We see a decision is binding and directly applicable to those to whom the decision is addressed. And this could be an EU country or an individual company. Commonly, decisions are sent, in response, to individual companies applying to import goods into the EU. Below that, recommendations and opinions. And both of these are legally non-binding to the recipient. However, on one hand, a recommendation may contain some sort of technical aspect. On the other hand, an opinion may contain some sort of regional or economic and social viewpoint. Okay, fab. Moving on. Placing goods on the market, positive lists and general licenses. Roughly speaking, the purpose of positive lists is to provide guidance on use of allowable materials in the production and supply of regulated commodities. In short, one might say, what you can use and how to use them. Positive lists are part of an approach designed to ensure compliance with regulations designed to limit adverse effects on humans, animals, and the environment to safe levels. They are applied, for example, to materials used in the supply or production of drinking water, food and feed, cosmetics, as well as in many other areas too. And new materials and processes can be added to the related positive list. But, as we shall see, there are steps to go through and hurdles to overcome in order to achieve this. And all in the name of safeguarding health, safety, etc., etc. And that's nice. In this video, we explore protocols and steps to place regulated food and feed on the UK market. And this necessarily involves positive lists. After this, we'll take a very quick look at a variety of general licenses which control imports of live animals, products of animal origin, POAO, and animal byproducts, ABP. Fab. Let's crack on. Positive lists of human food, animal feed and goods processing. Jumping to food.gov.uk. Placing a regulated product on the market. The pre-market approval procedure to place human food and animal feed products on the UK market. Down a bit. Certain food and feed products, called regulated products, require authorization before they can be sold in the UK. And authorization is required for the following regulated product types. And links to more info on food.gov.uk to guide you through the authorization process and associated regulations for the 12 product and processes given here. We see. For most regulated product types, once products or processes are authorized, they are listed in relevant legislation, which also sets out how they can be used. In this way, the entire legislation sets out how attached products or processes should be used. And these listings are referred to as positive lists. Down a bit. However, we see three exceptions. These positive list items currently do not appear in legislation. However, these types may be placed on the market if they meet requirements of the general food law and general criteria as set out in the food enzyme and food contact material legislation. Further guidance here. Contact email there. That's nice. But we also get an insight into the authorization process for food and animal feed products. Placing your product on the market in Great Britain. In brief, after a risk assessment, advice is provided to government ministers who decide whether a product can be placed on the market in England, Scotland and Wales. And we'll see a link for Northern Ireland applications at the bottom of this page, but for now, if a product or process is authorised, the related legislation is amended in order to set out any conditions as well as how the product or process can be used. But this summary is expanded upon in the paragraphs below. We see the authorization process and the risk assessment is carried out in accordance with harmonized EU legislation and guidance previously developed by the European Food Safety Authority, EFSA. And you can find out about requirements, information you need to submit from here. And following on, we see applications for related product and process authorizations are first checked for completeness before being thoroughly risk assessed by joint expert groups and / or scientific advisory committees, whilst also giving consideration to other legitimate factors, such as environmental risks, etc., in order to form a combined evidence package. And a recommendation, based on this evidence, is made to government ministers, who will then decide whether or not to provide the authorization. If approved, then the positive listing in the appropriate UK legislation is updated. But prior to this decision, the applicant will also have an opportunity to comment by taking part in a consultation during the risk analysis process and before the final recommendation is made to. This whole process takes time, a year perhaps, but depending on the type of application, deadlines may be set in legislation. But if more information is needed, the application may be put on hold until the information is received. Fab. Scrolling down briefly. Use the Regulated Products Application Service to apply for a new regulated product authorization. Great. And more down here. Ongoing applications. Any incomplete UK applications held by the European Commission will need to be resubmitted using the Regulated Products Application Service we see here. And note, it will be worth including your EFSA question number in with your submission. This applies both to new authorizations and reauthorization applications, but any applications approved by the European Commission prior to the 1st of January 2021 will remain valid in the UK. And three examples where reauthorizations are needed every 10 years here. Also, email help available and a link to the NI protocol to place products on the Northern Ireland market. Quickly, Annex 2 is split into product categories. So find your product type and then access the given EU regulations to get instructions for your particular import. And some regulations might be harmonized. And if you like, the Twols Club video, Conventions and Controls, explores the EU harmonizing procedure. Fab. Next. General licenses. Great. General licenses for live animals and POAO. Most imports of live animals and products of animal origin are already covered by UK legislation. Any new types of live animals will need to be authorised before they can be imported. And for example, if you want to find out if your imports of live animals or products of animal origin are covered by UK legislation, you can check out the APHA website as well as this and other pages on gov.uk. As an aside, if exporting to the EU, you can find help on gov.uk too. But just in case it helps, here is a handy list of links to customs authorities of the EU. On top of this, you might also want to check out the customs decision system of the EU. Anyway, moving on. Back to importing. And previously, when looking at positive lists for human food and animal feed, we saw that an authorization or pre-market approval was needed to place certain types of processes as well as food and feed on the UK market, including new processes and novel foods. As we shall see now. For many product types, importers also require what is referred to as a license before an import can take place too. And in some ways a license is similar to the pre-market authorization required for food and animal feed. And what are the similarities? Very generally, whether using the terms authorization or license for the applicable goods, both are needed prior to starting the import process. And details may be made available via regulations or some other official publication. However, if a license doesn't exist for your import, you will have to successfully apply for an authorization in order to get a license. And first, the authorization stages will investigate your product or process, and if authorized, the license spells out what to use and how to use it. And all this needs to be settled prior to the import process. So be prepared for that whole process to take some time. And To confirm about licenses, we see a list of types, including live animals and products of animal origin that are covered by what is called a general license. And links to more specific information for each of these types is given below. So, let's quickly skim that. Scrolling down. But, to reiterate, you can contact APHA to verify details of your scenario. Tell me more about the general license. Okay. Taking animal and animal products as an example. If your product type is covered by a general license, like the examples we'll see on this page, this means that in these cases, although you do not need to apply for individual import licenses, you must follow any instructions particular to your product type as set out in the general license applicable for your import. Pause as you like. After genetic materials, we see live animals, and all of these already have a general license. Keep scrolling down. Animal products for human consumption. And after that, animal products, not for human consumption. Research and diagnostic samples. And more. All of these have general licenses. Okay, great. Scrolling back up. We also see. If you cannot find a general license or authorization for what you want to import, you must apply for a new license. And by now, we can imagine that applying for a new license could end up being a lengthy process. What about animal byproducts not intended for human consumption? Licenses for animal byproducts not intended for human consumption, ABP. Ah yes. Licenses and approvals to import ABP. For certain products, high-risk animal byproducts. Traders will require at least some sort of approval prior to the start of the import process. And depending on the product, you can apply to DEFRA/APHA. For example, licenses are required to import products of or containing high-risk Category 1 and 2 ABPs. And we'll find out about Category 1 and 2 ABPs, as well as products of animal origin, POAO, in the next video. Okay, great. So, that is that. Next, in closing, SPS import controls after staging expires at the border. This video was made in 2021. And in these times of uncertainty, the UK government and HMRC have proved nimble, light of foot, and willing to adapt to circumstances to help businesses import and export, with the result that some temporary changes have been made to certain requirements. For example, requirements regarding supplementary declarations and entry summary declarations. For more details on this, watch the Twols Club video, General Aspects of UK Customs Border Controls. And as mentioned earlier, the staging of sanitary and phytosanitary border controls has been pushed back to give business more time to prepare as well. But what about when the staging process expires? What happens then? Full UK border controls will be in effect. Although not a complete list. When staging ends, one might expect the following. 1. Full customs declarations when applying for free circulation into the domestic customs territory. 2. Safety and security declarations. For example, exports will need exit summary declarations. But if you are the active means of transport for carrying goods into the destination customs territory, then you will also need to submit an entry summary declaration as well. But what else might customs authorities generally expect? 3. For imports of SPS goods. These often need health certificates and import pre-notifications, as well as 4. Conformity to general licenses or positive list legislation. But if an appropriate general license or authorization does not exist, then an application for a new license or authorization will need to be made, which might take some time, even prior to scheduling the import. And any new license or authorization, if granted, will contain conditions and procedures for the importer to follow. 5. Compliance to border checks. This may mean remote documentary checks, or any form of checks, at a border control post. Where necessary, checks may also be carried out at an inland site. Just to stress this point, entry for goods is via an appropriately designated border control post, a point of entry, especially for products controlled by sites rules, SPS rules, rules for controlled goods, and for other regulated products too. In this video, we've seen that SPS checks take the form of documentary, identity and physical checks including means of transport, packaging, as well as vehicle and driver checks, plus more. But, as an aside, if you want more information on checks regarding means of transport, vehicle and driver checks, why not watch the Twols Club video, Introduction to Welfare Regulations for Farm Animals and Equines in Transport, FAB. But also, 6. All SPS imports to comply with general and product-specific SPS rules and legislation. 7. Keep up to date with changing rules. In these rapidly changing times, this last point is as important today as it has ever been. More so perhaps. Okay, great. Jumping to imports and exports, general inquiries. And so, the next 7 videos are all much shorter. Let's list the titles here. And we'll get a brief description of the related SPS product type in each of these videos too. Fab. And don't forget, if you are also interested in animal welfare, then check out the Twols Club video. Introduction to welfare regulations for farm animals and equines in transport. Okay, great. After these videos. And as an aside, earlier on, back in August 2020, I looked at the gov.uk/transition pages and delved into several announcements from there too. I also recorded a test run of the Check Change Go Wizard. All in one video. Called Travel, Residency and Trade, a primer to help you check change go. And I enjoyed making that. Perhaps you may enjoy watching it too. Anyway, I'd like to close with a reminder from earlier videos. Specifically, my videos are not a replacement for the official sources, where you can find contacts, if you need any assistance too. Furthermore, my videos will get out of date, and I'll update them as and when I can. But if they can help you, or anyone you know, to more quickly digest information from UK and EU customs websites, and to also, more easily, absorb any future information and updates from such official sources, then my job here is indeed done. But also, a big cheer to anyone watching my videos, simply to pass the time to. Hurrah! And that's nice. Okay, I'm wrapping it up there. Smart. See you in the next Twols Club video. Bye.